Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Is there no end to man's inhumanity to man? Well, it begins certainly centuries ago, and that is the story that my guest Jonathan Kirsch tells, The Grand Inquisitor's Manual, A History of Terror in the Name of God, published by Harper One. Welcome, Jonathan.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here.
Thank you. It's always, I don't want to do after you, Alphonse, but it's always, Jonathan, you know, a pleasure for me to read what you write, because it is not a dumbing down of America when one reads any of your books, especially the interpretation of the Bible. But now you have gone in for historical fact. This is nonfiction based on your research.
It's true. I've written 7 books about the history of religion and religious texts, and it's kind of a march forward through history, starting with the Bible and the writing of the Bible. And this is an unavoidable stop in that history. This is the point at which government and religion allied themselves and created an institution, the Inquisition, which was designed to enforce a particular approved religion to the exclusion of all others and on the pain of death. And
now, most people think Inquisition, the Jewish people. Not so. It begins really earlier with the Cathars. Who were the Cathars?
Well, my book is full of what I hope and confidently predict will be surprises, if not shocks, to the reader. The idea that the Inquisition was aimed at the Jews is a historical fiction. In fact, Jews fell outside the jurisdiction of the Inquisition. The Inquisition was an effort by the Pope and the Roman Catholic Church to police Christianity and to enforce the proper form, or what they regarded as the proper form, of Christian worship. And its first target was a group of Christians living in the south of France called the Cathars. It was a religious community that has a lot of similarities to what we would today describe as the Protestant denomination. They were dissenters from the Roman Catholic Church, but they regarded themselves as good Christians. And because they did not worship in precisely the way prescribed by the Roman Catholic Church, the Cathars were condemned as heretics. They were slandered viciously. They were accused of horrible crimes, which they did not commit. They were the targets of a crusade, and they were the first victims of the Inquisition.
At the same time as there was the Vatican and Rome, there was something called the Eastern Catholic Church.
Well, Christianity, like every religion, has diverse aspects because human beings are diverse by nature. It's hardwired into who and what we are as human beings to have differences of opinion, differences of religious practice. There was the Roman Catholic Church seated in Western Europe. There was a so-called Eastern Orthodox Church in Eastern Europe. At the time of the Reformation, there was a third great force in Christendom, the Protestant denomination. And they each claim to be the one true version of Christianity.
Yeah. God keep us from fundamentalists.
Yeah, good. Amen to that.
Okay. They start now with, how do you find out who is the spy? Who is the one that is taking our people away from the right, true religion? And how can we torture them to get the truth out?
The Inquisition prefigures many things that are very familiar to us in the modern world.
Including
waterboarding, which was one of the favorite tortures of the Inquisition. Yeah. They called it the ordeal by water. We have a new euphemism, waterboarding. It's the same thing. It's indisputably a form of torture. And it's one of the many legacies of the Inquisition that is still to be found in the modern world. What I argue in my book and try to prove in my book is that the idea of an authoritarian police state, so much like what we saw in Nazi Germany and in Stalinist Russia and elsewhere, actually begins with the Inquisition, which had an army of spies and informers. It had its own police force, its own torturers, its own executioners.
And they kept good records. That's, again, the German, the Nazi, Hitler's willing volunteers there. They kept records.
Well, the Inquisition was utterly convinced that it was doing God's work. This is what one of the things that makes it such a dangerous phenomenon. They were proud of what they were doing. They didn't want to keep it a secret per se. They kept copious records. They took down every word of the victim under interrogation, every cry of pain, every penny and pound that was spent to buy firewood to burn heretics at the at the stake. And as a result, much of what we know about the Inquisition and what we know about the victims of the Inquisition comes from the inquisitors themselves.
Who was Bernard Guy?
Bernard Guy was one of the authors of a so-called Inquisitor's Manual. My book is called The Grand Inquisitor's Manual. There were, in fact, several manuals. They were standard operating procedures. Mm. They were how-to books written by prominent inquisitors. Yeah. Bernard Guy is perhaps the most famous and influential of them. And these were books that told inquisitors how to recognize a heretic, how to interrogate a heretic, how to punish a heretic. They provided scripts to be followed during the interrogation and torture. They provided forms to be used when consigning a victim to the stake.
They would send out two at a time. They weren't really priests. They were Vatican officials, really, I guess, from the bishop or from the cardinals. And they would come into a city and they would give a very serious sermon. And then they would say, those of you who want to recant in a sense, told it's okay, stand and raise your hand. And then it would begin. Who in your neighborhood? Who is your friend?
Well, one of the inventions of the Inquisition, and again, it resonates down through history. It was a feature of the Hollywood blacklist. A person accused of heresy could spare themselves the worst punishments, including burning at the stake, by confessing. But confessing one's own heresy was never enough. You had to name names, your wife, your husband, your children, your friends, your acquaintances. Unless you sent others into the Inquisition on a betrayal or a denunciation, your confession was considered to be imperfect and would not be accepted, and you yourself would end up on the stake. And of course, this was a terribly corrosive rule of law which destroyed families, destroyed communities, and was intended to do precisely that, to spread fear and mistrust.
Jonathan, there's a part of me as I read it that I keep hearing the line, it's the economy, stupid, that the church also wanted the land. And if somebody was, one of the heretics in their head, they could take his land. They could take his money.
Well, one of the victims of the Inquisition in the Middle Ages said, it's a pity that the inquisitors must burn in order to eat. In other words, they lived on the money and property that they seized from their victims. And once that bounty was on the heads of the victims, they were constantly, restlessly looking for new potential heretics. They would even disinter the corpse of a dead person who'd been buried for 50 years in order to dispossess that person's heirs, his children, from the inheritance that they got from the dead heretic. They'd put corpses on trial. And this was a great engine of pillage that went on for 600 years. One great example is the very famous and legendary Knights Templar, a order of the Roman Catholic Church that developed during the Crusades and was reputed to have a great treasure. Well, the King of France decided he wanted to have the Templars' treasure, so he put the Inquisition to work seeking out the Knights Templar, accusing them of vile crimes, putting them to torture, all in order to enrich himself.
Was that King Robert and Queen Constance?
That's an earlier episode. This was Philip the Fair. King Philip of France is the great despoiler of the Knights Templar.
Pope Gregory is the one who said, you may not marry. There may not be any chastity is the demand.
This is the great so-called Gregorian Reform, mm-hmm. named after Gregory. And this is one of the great ironies of the Inquisition. Many of the people who were accused of being heretics were what we would call reformers. They saw abuses and inequities mm-hmm. in the church, and they wanted to correct them. The Pope himself, Pope Gregory himself, tried to reform the church. St. Francis of Assisi, Domingo, the founder of the Dominican Order, they were all reformers of the church. But when you stood a little bit too far outside the church and called for reform, unfortunately, you were a heretic.
Yeah.
And ironically, the Franciscan Order and the Dominican Order became the shock troops of the Inquisition.
How did the Inquisition then move in at the late 1300s to Spain?
The Inquisition had several phases and several areas of operation. Mm-hmm. As you've pointed out, Connie, it began in southern France against the Cathars, but it was always looking for new victims, and it was always used by willful kings and rulers as an instrument of oppression of their enemies. Well, what happened in 1492, the famous year that Columbus sailed to America to China and found America, the same monarchs who sent him on his voyage declared that everyone in Spain must be a Catholic. And so the Jews of Spain had a choice. They could either leave Spain, and they had 90 days to do it, or convert to Catholicism. That's when the Spanish Inquisition came into force, because the inquisitors did not truly believe that any Jew could earnestly convert to Christianity.
And that comes Torquemada.
And that's Torquemada, the great grand inquisitor, the grandest of them all. And his mission in life was to seek out those converted Jews and later Muslims who claimed to be Christians, who he suspected of being secret Jews or secret Muslims, put them to torture, put them to death. And as we mentioned earlier in our conversation, these Jews became victims of the Inquisition only because they attempted to convert to Christianity. If they had remained professing Jews, they would have been beyond the jurisdiction of the Inquisitor.
Well, they were then told to get out of Spain.
That was their choice.
Yeah, but by that point, there were a couple of generations of converso Jews or converso to Christianity, and they were doctors in the Queen's Court, and suddenly it was like the Nazis who said, "You have a Jewish grandfather?"
Exactly right. The Nazi model of racial purity laws, the so-called Nuremberg laws, which historians point as the first step of the Holocaust, the first phase of the Holocaust, was to isolate the Jews by denying them German citizenship because they had the wrong blood in their veins.
Yeah.
This is an invention of the Inquisition as well. In Spain, if you were not of pure Christian blood, if you carried Jewish blood in your veins, you were subject to legal disabilities. You're not allowed to practice certain professions. You're not allowed to hold certain offices. And the Inquisition used those laws of racial purity as a basis for hunting down, torturing, and executing converted Jews. This is another parallel between what happened in the distant past and what happened within living memory.
Yeah. And the fact, too, that a person who was of Jewish religion would be brought in and said, okay, who do you know who is a converso, who still will, not eat certain foods and will have not Easter dinner, but the Passover.
Sure. The informers, the spies, the tools of the Inquisition went into the Jewish community before it was expelled en masse and tried to turn Jew against Jew, or to put it more accurately, Jew against converted Jew. And you could imagine there were a lot of tensions between people who remained in the Jewish faith and those who had converted,
and
they cynically used those tensions to their advantage.
And I didn't know till I read your book there were certain names for the people of Islam who converted, the Muslims.
It's true. There were both so-called conversos from Judaism and so-called conversos from Islam, and they were both victims of the Spanish Inquisition, the Jews in greater numbers. But the Inquisition was convinced that neither a former Jew nor a former Muslim could ever earnestly choose a new religion. One of the examples that I give in my book is, if you were a woman who had been raised in Judaism, converted to Christianity, and you were seen to change your underwear on Saturday, that was evidence that you were a secret Jew. Yeah. If you were a former Muslim converted to Christianity, and you were seen to eat couscous on any day of the week, that was evidence that you were still a Muslim. And either one of those entirely innocent acts was put to use as evidence in the courts of the Inquisition on which people were burned.
And you do bring it up to date that at certain places, if you see three young men eating couscous in a restaurant, as of today, there is a sense of who are they, what are they doing, and let's report their names.
Well, you know, this goes full circle, and I make this point in my book. In the War on Terror following the tragic events of 9/11, there was this sense that anyone of Arab descent or of Muslim affiliation was suspect. This is one of the great legacies of the Inquisition as well. It's to demonize your enemy, to dehumanize your enemy. There was a report that the FBI was monitoring the sales of couscous and other Middle Eastern foods at grocery stores in order to determine whether there were Al-Qaeda cells active in a particular area of America. Now, this turned out to be a futile effort because anyone, the fact that someone enjoys Middle Eastern food, in which group I put myself, doesn't mean that they're a terrorist.
Yeah.
But this fear and the suspicion, which was a tool of the Inquisition, has been used in the War on Terror.
You have pictures here of the square in Barcelona with the auto de fe going on, meaning they were burnt at the stake. It became, to my mind, reading this, madness of crowd.
It's true, and the Inquisition played on the popular fear, stirred up the popular fear and suspicion. This is another phenomenon we've seen in the War on Terror. The auto de fe, the great public burnings of accused heretics during the Spanish Inquisition, was a form of popular entertainment. It was a spectacle. They were put on by impresarios who prepared the crowds and built the crowds and arranged the ceremony so that it was ornate and colorful and also fearful, and it built to the climax of the mass burnings of heretics. This was a major form of popular entertainment during the period of the Spanish Inquisition.
Papal bulls that came out that gave those who were burning and looting the heretics permission.
Well, what we should never forget, and it's one of the most important points that I try to make in my book, is that the Inquisition was not a freelance enterprise. It was not like a pogrom or a lynch mob. It was done under the rule of law. The popes who invented the Inquisition were lawyers themselves, canon lawyers. There was a body of law that sanctified everything that the Inquisition did. One of the things that it did, a nice catch-22, is that anything that an inquisitor did that was in violation of canon law could be excused by another inquisitor, so they could absolve each other of law violations. But to this day, this is one of the most surprising things about the study of the Inquisition. As evil and as violent and as vile as the Inquisition was, it has its apologists and defenders, and one of their major arguments is this was not a violation of law. This was people deputized by the law carrying out and enforcing the law. Well, we would recognize today that the law itself was evil, but the apology is made that they were just doing what the law required.
And the Inquisition traveled. It went to Portugal. And you say up until what, 1814?
The last person to be murdered, I would say murdered, the last person to be executed by the Inquisition is 1826, 50 years after the Declaration of Independence. And the Inquisition remained in formal existence until 1834. And I want to say, among the other ironies is, the office in the Vatican which supervised the Inquisition was never put out of existence. It was renamed And the man who headed this office until 2005 is a man who is today Pope Benedict. In other words, there's a continuity to the Inquisition that's that has persisted into our own times. It was in active operation, actively hunting out, persecuting, and killing people for 600 years.
Including New Mexico?
Wherever Spain went, wherever Portugal went, in the age of exploration, the Inquisition went with them.
What about England? I think you mentioned England was sort of spared, but then it had its own problems.
The early Inquisition was all over Europe. As the years went by, it tended to recede into southern Europe, primarily Italy, Spain, and Portugal. Yeah. The Inquisition never operated in England with one exception when the Knights Templar were under investigation. Flying squads of inquisitors came to England to look for victims. But there were no inquisitorial courts in England.
Jonathan, what do you want people to take from this book?
I want to point out that the Inquisition invented what I call in my book an inquisitorial toolkit, a set of ideas, values, and techniques, including techniques of torture, and that that toolkit has never been closed. It's been in use throughout our history. It was in use at Abu Ghraib and in Guantanamo and at the secret prisons of the CIA. In other words, the dangers of the Inquisition are not something that we can confine to a dusty shelf in a library. They are threats that are present in our own world, even today, even as you and I speak.
And that sort of brings us full circle to man's inhumanity to man.
Well, religion, a subject that I've written on repeatedly, has the power to exalt humankind, to encourage good behavior, decent, just behavior, loving behavior. That's the highest and best calling of religion. But it's indisputable that religion has its dark side. Never was there a darker chapter to the history of religion than the Inquisition. And that's the dark side that I visit in my book.
And all it takes is one man like a Torquemada who shamed at certain points Isabella and Ferdinand to do what he said.
It's one of the most horrifying sidelights of the Inquisition is that Isabella was inclined to protect the Jews. She called them my Jews. Yeah. She felt that they were her special charge. And Torquemada agitated and propagandized and used whatever influence he had, which was considerable, to turn these monarchs against the Jews.
What's the next investigation from my friend Jonathan Kirsch?
Well, I have a new book, and I'm taking notes. It's a little something different. It's still in the field of the religious imagination, but all I'm prepared to say is it's about the interplay between the religious imagination and the erotic imagination of human beings.
Well, wait a minute. You don't even have to. You have it in this book with the people who were torturing these young people and had the women stark naked or the men naked, and that there was a sort of an erotic quality to their torture.
Well, anyone who's read De Sade knows that there are some sexual imaginations that are titillated by the combination of pain and sex, and that was absolutely a feature of those torture chambers.
And Cervantes had to censor his own book, Don Quixote.
Even Cervantes and a great many others fell victim of the Inquisition in that way as well.
Jonathan, thank you so much. Will you autograph my book? And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me at ConnieMartinson.com. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier and see some of our shows. And if you want to see more, visit us at the Claremont Graduate Library Digital Center. There they are digitizing our archives. And support your local library, because libraries are our finest democratic institution. Anyone who has a problem with reading will learn to read better, and they also have large print books. Take a child with you, never forget you. And that library also is a way of enduring the better part of human nature. And they have music, they have shows, and better, they have books. So whatever you can do, support your library. If you hear their budget is being cut, stand up, make a difference, write to your congressperson to fight any budget cutting of libraries. And we'll see you next time. Thank you, Jonathan.
Thank you. What a pleasure.
Thank you.